All right, thank you for coming, everybody. It's now 10 a.m. in Australia, or 12 p.m. if you're in New Zealand, and time to get underway with our Reconciling Reports and Practice Manager webinar. My name is Gareth. Let's get started. So today what we're going to talk about is those reports that you print as part of your month-end process. And so we'll start off with the first step in the month-end process, which isn't actually related to reports, but which we do in order to be able to run our reports. Then we get right into those reports that we run, starting off mainly with the control report and looking at how we can match that report to all the other reports that we print as part of our month-end process. So there'll be a number of reports that we'll be comparing to, and I'll take you through each of those. After we've reconciled the control report, we'll have a look at the productivity report as well, because some people do like to reconcile that one. And during the process of reconciling the control report, I'll actually be showing you a couple of extra reports that are not in your standard AO Practice Manager installation. So if we have some time, I'll take you through how to download those, or how to find and download those reports and import them into your existing software. So let's jump straight into it. The first step in our month-end process, before we've done anything else, is to lock the time period that we're finalizing. And so the reason that we do that, of course, is we want to make sure that any reports we run don't change their figures after the fact. So we close that period off first, that then lock that in place. That means that we can't put any additional transactions into that period. No timesheets, no invoices, no receipts, no adjustments. That period is locked. We can then print all of our month-end reports and know that those figures are always going to be the same. So I'll just take you quickly through a little demonstration of how to do that. Jump into the product here. And so if you're in Accountants Office Practice Manager, you would go up to your maintenance drop-down menu at the top of the screen, into the maintenance map option there, which is where all of our configuration items are stored. And you can either scroll down the list of areas, or you can click on the taskbar straight down to the time setup area, because under time setup, the processing time setup option is the one we want to choose. Click on that option. And what we want to do is tick the close tick box next to the month that we're closing off. So we simply tick that box, and that's enough to lock that period and stop any additional transactions being put to that month. When you tick that box, if there is anything unpostal or anything that needs to be resolved, when you tick the box, it will actually print a report which shows you items that need to be resolved before that period can be posted. So in this case, I can't close off May because I still have a bill there for May sitting there unposted. So I need to and either post or delete that bill before I can tick the closed box. So if you do get that report, just action those items first and then come back and tick it. Now, ticking the box is not the end of the story. If you do need to go back to a period and make adjustments, you can go back and untick the tick box, and that then unlocks the period you're able to put your adjustments through. Of course, if you do that and make some adjustments, do remember to come back and tick it again, and then, importantly, rerun your control report and other reports, because those numbers will have changed, of course. So that's how we close off the month. Once we've closed off the month, we can now be confident that our report figures are not going to change, so we can go and have a look at the month-end reports. Now, the way we get to our month-end reports is we go through the drop-down menu under the Reports button and select Favorites. Because if you're running a report on a regular basis, that report should be in your favorites. So if I go into my favorites and have a look, here are all of my favorite reports. We've actually given you a month-end favorites list to start you off, but you can add to that and add additional reports to that report set, as well as creating any additional report sets as well. If you haven't already, you should have created a report set under your personal favorites. One isn't there by default, so until you've actually gone and done that, you can't add reports to your personal favorites. So from here, we should come and run all of these standard reports that we need to run at the end of the month, starting off with this first one, which is actually not one of our standard ones. I've added that to my favorites in order to be able to run it, which is the client partner check. So if you haven't got that in your favorites already, what you would do is go to your reports button, which is, we only go to that reports button when we're looking for a report that we haven't used previously. And in the report button, there is an area on the taskbar called client partner check, just one report in that area. And since we're going to be running that quite a lot, right-click and add that to your favorites so that you don't need to come find it again. Once it's in your favorites, we can run it from here by either right-clicking and saying Run Report, or use the item on the taskbar, Run Report. And what you should see in the client partner check is just a single line that says unspecified. So that means that there are no clients there who haven't had a partner specified. If you have a list of clients here, those clients need to have a partner assigned to them. The reason we want all clients to have a partner assigned is some of our reports group or summarize by partner, and so for those clients that don't have a partner, they can be left out. So that's the first check that we would run before we do anything else. After that, the next report that we'd usually run is this control report by client company. I'm going to run the control report for the month of August and reconcile the month of August for you. So we run that from the first of the month to the last of the month and click OK. And that comes up with our control report, like so. Technically, you should go to the last page, which has the grand total, but since you only have the one company, you don't need to worry about that too much. And so at the top of the report, we have the WIP control, and at the bottom, we have the debt control, and we're going to have a look at those numbers going down the left-hand side, looking at each one and how we would reconcile that number to a supporting report. I'll do the first one here in the program, and then we'll go back to our slides and go through the rest. And so the first number that I have here is the period-to-date balance of opening balance WIP. In the WIP control, 29,831.58 is my opening balance. Where would I reconcile that from? Well, I can reconcile that from a number of places, actually. I could use the age WIP report, the client summary, or even the control report from last month. I'll use the age WIP report to reconcile that because it gives me a nice level of detail for the different clients. We'll run that report, and the main thing, of course, is that since it's the opening balance for August, I need to run that report up to the end of the previous month. Click OK there, and if I go to the last page and look at the total balance, 29,831.58, that matches the figure that I have as my opening balance in my control report. So there we go, we're happy that those two figures are the same. My control report is balancing to the rest of the system. Okay, let's go back to our slideshow here. Move on a few slides. So we've talked about the favorites and the client partner check. The control report and the other reports that we're going to go through here, the first six are actually in your monthly and favorites to start with, so we can just use those as are. There are some additional reports that I'll be referring to in the bottom part of that slide, and you might want to add some of those to your favorites. The first and third of those lines at the bottom of the slide, there are actually additional reports that I'll show you if we have time how to download from our knowledge base. Bit more about the control report there, which we've already talked about. That's the key report that everything reconciles back to. And so we take that as the summary and then use the other reports for the detail. And so we have a table here, which is in the PDF that I made available to you to download. If you want to download that, if you haven't already, just press Control T at any time to download that PDF. I won't go through the table, but you can see on that table has the fields from the control report on the left, and the other areas are detailing exactly which report and which field on that report are the ones that you reconcile against. We'll skip past all of those and go to some nice pictures instead. Here we go. So that's the one I've just done. The opening balance of WIP matches to the closing balance of the previous period's age WIP report. The next figure down, the opening balance of time, we'll reconcile back to our last month's control report. And so as you can see, the period is the previous month. The closing balance of that month is the opening balance of this month, so we're all good there. You can use other reports like client balance summary timesheet reports, but that's the one that we've chosen to reconcile to at the moment. The next one is plus time charged. So the $4,050 that we charged during the month can be reconciled back against your timesheets. And in this case, I've used a summary timesheet report. But you could equally use the detailed timesheet report if you wanted to see the line-by-line of the timesheets. The total of the charge at the bottom matches our plus time charge on the control. How much did we bill during the month? $2,000. And if we print off our debtors invoices per type summarized, that's one of our new additional reports that I'll show you on the knowledge base. It's very useful because it groups everything by the type of WIP. We can see in that report the $2,000 worth of time. If you wanted to make a more detailed version which lists it by invoice, you can do. Just remember to group it by the code type so you split out the time from the disbursements and other types of WIP. The write-offs are very conveniently on the same report, so we can match those against the control report total as well. And then our closing balances, we can actually get that from our client summary. The main thing to just be aware of is that the client summary groups time and estimates together. So when you're looking at the grand total there, you've got to be aware that there are two figures on the control report that you're matching to your client summary. You can see those two numbers, if we take one minus the other, do match to the client summary figure. Moving down to the opening balance of disbursements, just like we did for the opening balance of time, we can get that from the previous month's control report. Disbursements charged during the month. Again, we go back to our time or disbursement reports and print off a detail of what disbursements have been put through the system. The total of that charge should match our control. And back to our debtor invoices report to get the amount billed during the month. There's the $50 net that was billed. And the write-offs are also on the same report for handling. Closing balance, once again, we can go back to the client summary. And just be aware that that actually has the miscellaneous charges included in that disbursement total. Having said that, it is extremely unusual to carry forward a miscellaneous charge balance, so I would expect to see that as zero, and that column would just be the disbursement charge most times, at almost all times. Opening balance miscellaneous charges, we have for the other two areas of WIP. You just pick up the closing balance from the previous month. Plus, during the month, we don't actually usually have miscellaneous charges sitting there from last month or entered during the month, which give us a charge and ongoing. Debtor invoice reports will give us that figure as long as we're grouping by code type. So we can see there the $350 and also the minus $350, which is how our miscellaneous charges work. We write it up and bill it, or we write it off and credit it during the month. Didn't need to reconcile the closing balance because we've already looked at that when we looked at the closing balance of disbursements. It reconciled both of those totals into the one on the client summary. Opening balance of estimates. Once more, we go back to the previous month's control and make sure that figure matches. Estimates fee during the month. We go back to our debtor invoice reports, and it's nicely in there. And the write-offs as well, although we don't usually see those until we do a wash-up bill. And then the closing balance, which we can get from the client summary, as I mentioned earlier, but we can get much more easily by looking at our aged WIP report. So that's giving us the estimates column there, and we can see what estimates are still outstanding at the end of the month. And we can use the same figure to give us the total WIP for the end of the month. So the closing balance of WIP from the control should match the total balance from the aged WIP by client partner. Just pausing to let everybody notice that it doesn't balance at the moment. Oh no! I'll show you what to do about that shortly. So at the moment, almost everything balances, but unfortunately my closing balance of WIP doesn't balance, and I will show you how to resolve that difference. Okay, we have a similar sort of table for the debtor error at the bottom of the control report. Again, I won't go through the table, but we'll look at the nice pictures instead. So looking at the bottom part of the control report, we have our opening balance, and we can reconcile that gross figure to our aged debtors report for the previous month. We could also use the client summary, or at least those ones that have a debtors balance on it as well. We use the aged debtors by preference. Then we have our total fees figure, so what invoices have been posted during the month. We can get that from our fee reports. We don't need to group it by our code type this time, so it's just a straight invoice listing. And the gross figure is there and matches, as does the tax and the net figures as well. The receipts can be reconciled to the receipts list. Both of these are standard reports in the month end. So a list of our receipts for the month is our gross, tax, and net figures, which should all balance. And then moving down, we've got our discounts, our adjustments, and our bad debts, all of which are collectively called adjustments in the user interface. So we have a new report, which is available from the knowledge base, which lists all of our adjustments. It was written in the adjustment area, which doesn't have any default reports. It does actually give you a subtotal by adjustment type. So if you had numbers in those three categories, it would give you a subtotal you could reconcile back to each one. In this case, I've just put the one adjustment through, so you can see that coming up as the total. Gross, tax, and net, once again. And the closing balance can be reconciled back to our aged debtors report. So the total balance of aged debtors matches the total balance of our control report. And so that's going through all of those numbers on the control report, looking at another report to back those numbers up and provide us more detail where we can see client by client if there are any differences, which will become important right now. And so with the control report and with all of the reports in the system, really, the main thing to remember is that you can't really get them out of balance. There are two reasons that the reports will get out of balance. One of them is that the client doesn't have a partner assigned, which is why we run the client partner check at the beginning to make sure that there aren't any of those. And the second reason, the more common reason, is that you've billed transactions or timesheet entries or disbursement entries that are dated after the date of the invoice or the bill that you've created. It's very hard to do that automatically because if you do enter an invoice date and then bill some WIP which has a date on it as well, every stage of the invoice from that point onwards will warn you that you are billing things dated after the invoice date, so you have to actually override those warnings to carry on. But if you do choose to do that, the control report will go out of balance for that period. So there is a knowledge base article, but I'll just quickly take you through the process to see what do we do if we find those reports are out of balance. So first thing we do, as I said before, is run the client partner check. Just make sure there aren't any clients that haven't been assigned to a partner, or anyone that had the partner deleted. And then the second thing to do is run a control report and date it off into the future. So let's do that now. Just going to let me close some of these reports that I've been running. Go back to my system. So I'm going to run that control report again. We're trying to reconcile August. So it's from the 1st of August. But rather than going to the end of August, I'm going to go out a bit into the future. If you go a month out, I'm going to go to the end of the year and click OK there. And so this is a control report going off into the end of the year, and I can see that at the end of that period, my closing balance of WIP is 39526. Now, to reconcile that, I go and print a client summary or an aged WIP report, one of those reports that I was looking at previously, and we'll give it the same period, of course, so from the 1st of August to the end of the year. And then we can look at the total WIP outstanding at the bottom of that report and see that's 39,526.58 as well in that third column, total WIP outstanding. And so that's good news. That means that my reports do actually balance once they get to December, but they're out of balance for the period of August. And so once you've been reassured by that, the next thing to do is find out which entry is actually causing it to go out of balance. And so what we do there is we run two reports. We run the client summary for the month that it's out, and we run the aged WIP report for that same month and find the clients that have different balances in between those two reports. So again, let's just quickly do that. If I run the, I run that client summary report. Now, I ran it to the end of the year, but I'm going to go back and run it for August again. Here's the client summary report for August. Excuse me if I zoom into the client that I'm about to demonstrate it with. And then we'll run the aged WIP report. And we'll do that to the end of August as well. There it is. And so in this report, if we're going through and ticking off all the individual clients, we will quickly notice that AAA car dealership here under Ian Jones has a balance of $15 of WIP on the aged WIP report. But if we go to the client summary report for the same period, his total WIP outstanding is actually minus $85 because he has a WIP credit sitting in there. So that's how we identify which of the individual clients are actually causing us to go out of balance. Once you've found the clients, the next step is to go and look up those clients. And in the bills tab of that client, you'll have the invoices that have been posted for the month that you're trying to reconcile. Highlight those invoices, hopefully there's not too many of them, and click the report button at the bottom, which will give you a detailed WIP report of what went on that invoice. When we run the WIP report, it gives us the invoice, which is dated 4th of August, and a list of the WIP entries, and we can quickly see there's a WIP entry there dated 4th of November. And so that's what's caused the problem in my control report. That's why it went out of balance. So, what do I do about that? Well, there's two options you could take. The first option is to reverse out that invoice that caused the problem, and then re-enter the invoice, excluding that future dated WIP. Then your reports would be back in balance. The other option is simply to wait, because once it's passed, once the control period that you're printing the reports for has passed that timesheet date, everything will go back into balance. So it's up to you. But that's how you find out if your reports are out of balance, and if they are, which clients are causing it, which invoice is causing it, and what to do about it. Okay. Now, once we've reconciled the control reports to all those other WIP and debt reports, a lot of practices reconcile the productivity as well. If you are reconciling the productivity report, just remember, if you're including budget figures, always date the report to the end of the month, because budget figures are all dated at the end of the month. That can cause some confusion. And the other thing is, make sure that the productivity report that you're using to reconcile to doesn't have any filters on it, because that can cause some employees to be excluded from the report, which again can cause it not to reconcile. So with those two things in mind, we have a table. Again, I won't go through the table. We'll look at the pretty pictures instead. Here they are. So on the left-hand side, I've got the employee productivity report, or at least one of them, the one including billing. And we can go through each individual figure, left to right, reconciling that to another report. The main report that we use for these is the employee performance summary. That is a summary report. You can reasonably easily customize that report to make it a detailed version if you want to. So looking at Denise here, we have 13 and a half hours charged, and we can reconcile that back to the performance summary, and there's 13 and a half hours charged there as well. Likewise, in the non-productive non-charge, i.e. the leave, we have 3.5 in both reports. Non-chargeable, but productive, and we have that total there as well. And the total hours is simply the total for that employee on the performance summary. That's a summary report. I said we can get a detailed version, although we don't have a standard one. But that's how we can check the totals on the productivity back to what's actually gone through that employee record. The next figure on the billing productivity report is not quite so simple to reconcile back to. What it's doing there is it's looking at the time period that we're printing the report for, and then it's comparing that to the timetable on the employee record. So depending on what the hours you've entered as worked, or as worked as a standard in the timetable tab, it will add up those hours in each of those days, depending on the date range, and give you a total in the standard hours column. That can take a little bit to work through if you're wanting to find out where that number's coming from. The charged dollars is also back on the performance summary. So apart from standard hours, all of the things in the timesheets area of the productivity report can be reconciled back to that performance summary report, which is in the employee activity area if you're looking for it. The productivity percentage numbers we don't actually need to reconcile, because they're just derived from the timesheet numbers. So as long as you know the calculation it's doing, you can get those. And if we go over to the billing section on the right-hand side, there we go back to our fee reports. And once again, the very handy additional report that I'll show you where you get that from shortly, we can get that number, the $2,000, from there, or we can make a detailed version if you wanted to go bill by bill. Write-offs are also on the same report, and so that's how we find out that our productivity report matches both what's gone through the timesheets and what's gone through the fees area. Right, now, I've talked about those additional reports. There's two key ones that I used there, the debtor invoices by code type summarized and the adjustments report. Let's have a look at how we can actually find and download those from our system. So I'm going to go on to our website, my.myob.com.au or my.myob.co.nz if you're in New Zealand. Hopefully you all have a login to that website. If you don't, please contact your client manager. And once you've logged into that site, use the link on the main page there, search the knowledge base. Clicking on that link will open up our knowledge base, and you can then do a search for knowledge base article 34548, and that's in the slides that you've got in the PDF. 34548 will take you to MYOBAO additional reports. And so this is a list of all the additional reports that we've created but not included in the default program. So they're available for download as required by you. So you can see there's quite a number there. We've used two of those in today's session, but there are lots of others that you can use, or you just use as inspiration. And so then at the bottom of the knowledge base article, we have a PDF which takes you through the process of actually importing, how to import those reports, which I'm about to show you anyway, as well as links to all of the individual reports. So you can click on one of those links and download the report to a place on your computer. You can tell it where to save to. Once you have saved those reports, say to your desktop, for example, which is where I've just put mine, just on the desktop there, then what you do is go into your Accountants Office software, and in Accountants Office, under the Report button, the drop-down, there is a Report Export and Import option. So click on Report Export and Import, and then in here you can choose any report area you like. Doesn't matter, but until you've clicked into one of these sub-areas, the Import button on the right is not available. So click into any report area, then click Import. Browse and choose the reports that you've downloaded, so hopefully you've found where to save those, where you saved those, and select Open. It'll then ask you whether it's a portrait or a landscape report. Well, our knowledge base article actually told you that, so if we scroll back up here, we can see that that's a landscape report, and so that's what we choose in the option. Click OK, and even though we might have had a different area selected, it knows where to go, and so it imports it into the correct area automatically. You can use that import option to import any additional reports that you like from that knowledge base article, and there are quite a number there. Okay, if you are wanting to customize reports, I did mention that you could turn some of those summary reports into detailed versions. There is another knowledge base article, I won't go into it, 348448, which takes you through quite a comprehensive process of creating or formatting reports in your report editor. So just remember that Accountants Office comes with a fully featured report editor, and you can create and customize reports in there to make them make them look exactly the way that you want them to look. All right, that's all of the content we have for you today. Oops, I had a question, so that's all good. With the employee productivity report, what happens if the employee hours vary from week to week? That is actually a very good question. So in your employee records, we have the employee with the timetable. And yes, if your employee's timetable varies from week to week, you may not be able to choose a certain number of hours per day as a standard. If you say this person is completely casual, they work different hours every day, you can zero that off. For example, the main things to be aware of there is that that standard hours field in the productivity report will then report 0 hours because there are no standard hours. You can still look at the hours they actually worked though, which are the other figures that we reconciled. The other key point, if you haven't put any standard hours in there, is just to make very, very sure that your report does not have a filter on it. If we look at one of these reports, and I use that one there, so we make sure there's no filter here, because if there is, and if I look at one of the other ones, I think we'll probably find a filter like so. So that filter would actually exclude that person where we've zeroed the standard hours from printing in the report. So just make sure that whatever report you use, that filter is not there if you've got any casual employees. Great question. Thank you very much for that. So as I said, this is the end of the content. I hope that was useful to you. Have a good rest of the day, and love your work.